first of all, I tell you what I will do. I will talk a little bit about myself. I'm sorry that this is not me, but you don't know me. No, first of all, I want to excuse that I'm not speaking Portuguese at all. That's why you have to deal with my lousy English, yeah, which is pretty rusty by now. So first, I will talk a little bit about myself. Then I'll give a little short lecture, which embraces, you could say, my philosophy as a filmmaker. Then, in a more impromptu fashion, I will talk a little bit about my films, my work, with showing you some samples of it, excerpts, clips. Susanna and André will assist me through that by asking certain things, or they have chosen certain excerpts and so forth, because they thought it might be interesting for you if I would talk about them. So you get, in a way, a look into my workshop, right? In my lab, in which I'm working, or have been working. After that, of course, if we still have time, I think, and if you are curious, we could talk a little bit about art education and about film schools and things like that. The various places I've been, the various places I've been heading, and so forth. So just to give you the taste of other institutions. But probably we are all some of the same kin. We are all from art schools, right? That usually resemble each other more than they are different. That's my guess, but it's up to you to decide. Especially there, I think your input would be very welcome. But you can, at any time, if something is not totally expressed in a way that you get it, what I said, or if you have additional questions or anything like that, you are welcome in the middle of it, of course, also to rudely interrupt me or the whole process and bring it forward, and I'll try to deal with that as well. Yeah, so don't be bashful and ashamed to interrupt me, please. Yeah. So first of all, I want to introduce myself. You know my name. I went to film school in the mid of the 60s at the newly founded Berlin Film Academy. At that time, all in West Germany, there was no film school at all. So it was, as very often when institutions start, they have an idea, but that idea is very vague. But of course, when it comes to teaching, you have to be precise. You have to have a curriculum and things like that. Unfortunately, this institution had none of it, right? They had just invited a bunch of students, and that was it. There were some faculty there, mostly directors, who also didn't know how to teach film, right? No idea. There was no model, no past experiences from the past, so just a bunch of vague ideas. Why don't I sit down? So that was somewhat unfortunate. After 2 years, I unfortunately had to leave that school. And when I looked at that moment at what I had learned there, it was close to nothing. I wouldn't know where to put the camera, for example. in order to shoot somebody entering through a door a room. Sounds easy, but I think you have some choices there, and very often you're not really conscious about what these choices entail, what they mean. Of course, you shoot something differently when somebody comes into a room as a surprise than somebody entering as a threat. Yeah, and you have to be very specific how to shoot that, yeah, if you want to be a film director. And these are sound trivial problems of filmmaking, but they are there. The bigger questions of filmmaking, of course, are that you need to be able to tell a story visually. You need to have an idea how to model a character in your, if you make a feature film, a narrative film. You have to understand quite a number of tricks of the trade. For example, how to work with actors. I mean, actors, usually as a student, you never have access to, right? Of course, actors are professionals themselves, and they have certain expectations how they can and want to be integrated into a crew while you're making a film. So none of that, all that was present. What we had, and that was actually something very good, we watched a lot of movies. We had a film history class that would last one day a week, a whole day. I saw a lot of films, and just by watching, of course, and films themselves are film schools in themselves. So I got something, but I didn't get the actual doing, right? So at that point, I found myself, after leaving the school, I found myself lost. So I said, well, if I haven't learned it yet, I have to do it myself. So I started much more intensive theoretical readings. I studied filmmakers, but I also studied films minutiously, cut by cut, shot by shot, and also frame by frame over a shot. So really looking almost like under a magnifying glass, what the directors and the editors and the cinematographers actually did in order to get a sense of the profession. This and something else I was doing previously before I went to film school, I was always writing. I also had in the back at least the desire to be a writer as well. And as I did so many studies in film, it ended in a book. Yeah, so all of a sudden I was not only an aspiring director, I was also somebody who wrote about films, filmmaking, film directors and such, right? So there were already two kind of complementary professions. But studying myself and teaching myself so much, in a way, I became a teacher as well. And so this is the three things that I did throughout my life. Writing about film, mostly about film, making films, and teaching films to students like you are, right? So of course, when you start a career, that's actually very beneficial because it's always pretty tight and difficult when you're a beginner to make some money. And let's say that you finish as a director, so after film school, you should reckon on almost 10 more years to establish a career. Yeah, it won't happen the day of your of your graduation that you'll find a job. No, it's a difficult time, and it's a difficult time to sustain yourself. So my rule of thumb is, after 10 years, you should have a career, which means you should have a name. You should, or some people should know you. You should have been in a few festivals with your work. But of course, the condition for that is that you continually do work. You make films, even if the budget is 1 cent. Yeah? Even if you can't put your hands on a camera, if you don't have a camera, make your film on a piece of paper, write your film, right? But keep in touch with it. If you just let it hang down there, you will lose everything that you learn, that you've learned. It actually needs continual practice to keep your perception and your mind and all the skills that accumulated to keep them alive, to have them in practice. That's very important. So, and back then it was pretty easy to do anything like that, because there were these 8mm cameras. Yeah, they were already out there. But there was no video. There were not these little video, not to talk about editing machinery facility or something like that. Today, with the investment of 10,000 euros, I think, you're a full-blown film industry of your own, right? You can buy from that decent camera. You can buy a decent computer, and you can buy decent editing software. Yeah. And then you're self-sufficient at that moment. You can make, well, films. You can work. So it's easy. It doesn't really these days cost that much anymore. So in a way, you're in a much more advantageous situation I was in back then. So, the main lesson is keep on working, showing stuff to people, looking out for projects, researching projects, go to shooting. Maybe if you, for one reason or another, can't shoot, what your former colleagues do, and if they need a hand and help, join them in the crew, because then you participate in their production process and you learn from that. So it's still a valuable time, even if you do have to do that for nothing. But still, you're attached to your profession. So, but after 10 years at least, you should be at a point where you get some budget. Yeah, maybe not much, where festivals are interested in your work, and where people know you, and your name is not an unknown person. No critic ever knows, right? So that's what I learned back then. I kind of went from film schools. By then, there were more film schools in Germany, and did a little teaching, one course here, one course there, and I discovered that actually as a faculty you learn when you teach, you learn as much from your students as you teach them. It's true. I don't know if my colleagues here agree, but for me it's a fact, yeah, because you are, I mean, as a student, you're in the constant process of appropriating the tools, the process of making films and work. And you come up with questions that might be old questions sometimes, but you pose that, these questions, in a new way, because you have different experiences and you have different desires and different goals, different ideas. And this is the kind of rejuvenating aspect of teaching. So it's actually, although sometimes you think it's a one-way thing, somebody is talking to you, being your teacher, it's never truly a one-way thing. You give back, although it might be unbeknownst to you. Yeah. So it's a mutual process of acquiring what cinema is, what filmmaking is, and this way you never lose contact with the essential questions that come appropriating from scratch, almost appropriating the tools you are working with. So, so in a way, I'm very content with my position. Yeah, having chosen three things at the time. Of course, when it gets very busy, let's say you're in high demand in filmmaking, of course your writing will suffer. Yeah, or you can't teach. That of course happens as well. But I tried not to completely move off to one side of my three professions and do only filmmaking. So I always did teaching on the side. I always continued to write. In the end, it happened that I became a faculty. You know the word faculty, which is teacher at a school in Berlin, at the place where I started myself as a student at the Film Academy in Berlin. And shortly after, I got the call to become the dean of the School of Film and Video at CalArts, which is a private college in the area of Los Angeles. And I stayed there as dean almost 15 years. But even there, as you can imagine, being a dean is mostly an administrative job. Yeah, you sit there and write letters and hire faculty and think about what to do with the big budget, all the money you got. Well, for me back then, we're a couple of million dollars, so I always complained. So yeah, that's true. Yeah, but I did one thing. I tried not to be completely the administrator, because you lose you know your faculty, okay, because you hire them and you evaluate them. But there's the danger that you don't know your student body, not the individuals that are there. The students tend to look at the dean or anybody from the administration. They're way out there. They know shit. They're totally uninteresting people, unless you want to get something, some privileges, some favorites or so. Then they knock usually at the door and beg for something. They could have this or that or this, and so forth. So, but that was not satisfying me. So I insisted, I was the boss, so I didn't have to insist, but I taught two classes each semester on top of it, sometimes three classes or four classes even. Although that was difficult, but only through teaching you really get to know students and to understand what kind of artistic project they are developing for themselves. They are kind of moving into, and you can be very helpful next to what you want to teach there. Yeah, so that was, I think, for me, the most fruitful part of that job. Well, it lasted a while, and then I was finished, and we wanted to go back to Berlin. And by that, I became professor at the University of the Arts, which is the institution, as I understand. I don't know ESAD too much, but I understand you have different departments. You have fine arts and things like that, not only filmmaking. And so Cal Arts, as well as the University of the Arts in Berlin, they had a music department, they had an architecture department, they had fine arts, I said already, they had a theater department, a film department, and probably something else. So they still have that. Yeah, so there's a certain comparability there with, I guess, your institution. And CalArts was just the same. And actually, we always try to have a crossover between the different departments, although they all had different budgets, according to the liking of the bosses of the private college. So it was difficult to take on students from other departments, say, okay, take the camera, or use this facility, or mix your film with us, or so. It was sometimes difficult. But we tried to the students to encourage the students to cross borders and to work, cooperate in a crew of various disciplines, because that's something you in your professional life will encounter all the time, yeah? That you all of a sudden have to talk to an architect, and then a graphic designer comes in, and so forth, although you're just a poor filmmaker, right? But you have to deal with all these disciplines. And this is a very good training experience to do this, to move into this, as long as you're studying and the institution, the facility of the institution, provides this kind of interdisciplinary access. So, but then I also did, when I came back to Berlin, I was the director of the Film Academy, the same place where I studied. And this is a standalone facility. This is an institution that's only teaching film. Of course, there are four, at least in this one, there were four different departments, which is directing, cinematography, production, and screenwriting. These were the four departments in which we were teaching there. Of course, was done in order to, from the beginning, to encourage students not to learn only something, but to collectively create a film. Collectively, I mean also by discipline, of course. Yeah, but it's good when a directing student works with the cinematography students from the beginning, right? So this is what I was finding there, and I, of course, encourage that too. But maybe we will later on talk a little bit more about film schools or whatever your interest here is. So do you at this point have any questions so far? Because I want to kind of deliver my little speech here. Not at this point, okay. But maybe later? Or not? Okay, good. So, this little text, I wrote it in German, but I'm translating now on the fly. So bear with me if sometimes I'm searching for the right English word, or don't find it at all and do some dancing here verbally. So that might happen. Please excuse that. But as I said earlier, I kind of put down some ideas that in a larger way encompass, at least for me, my working and somewhat the pilot beam along which I'm working, right? So I start with a quote of Levi-Strauss. Does the name ring with you? He's a structuralist and anthropologist. Okay, so it's no old stuff, old hat, we say. Good. He said, an artist in general is always engaged in a threefold dialogue, or he's entertaining three dialogues at the same time. The first is the dialogue, of course, with an audience, yeah, with the people who look at the work. And all this, what I'm saying, is not true only for filmmakers, it's true for all the arts, I think. You could also say you're involved in a dialogue with the consumer, right, or the recipient, which is the communication theory concept of the audience, and I don't like actually to think of my audience as recipients, as vessels that get filled with some messages, and then they act accordingly. But you're engaged there. So these days you very often say users, the users, and I think that's much conceptually a much more interesting a notion, yeah, to call it the user. So I'm, although it's a little bit fashionable, I'm okay with that. But of course, this dialogue is not a given thing. You can't rely on that it will happen. I mean, the history is full of misunderstandings. I'll give you one example. Jean Renoir, who we these days think is one of the greatest directors, made a film, Partie de Campagne, a Sunday Trip. He didn't even totally finish it, so it's a shorter film, like 30, 45 minutes. People at that time hated it. Yeah, they couldn't deal with it. It was totally uninteresting. And then 50 years later, someone rediscovered. And now this film that was so rejected at a given time is one of the masterpieces of filmmaking, right? You see, something didn't work in the dialogue with the audience. Renoir at that time tried to bring forward. Or, of course, another form of mishap dialogue is censoring, right? So the censors are also your audience you're talking with. And they sometimes are offended or have specific political interests, and they just cut out. I don't know if you have censorship still in Portugal, do you? No, it's gone? Yes, of course. Yeah, that's definitely something where the concept is appropriate, I would say. In production, of course, there is a lot of censoring going on. These type of films get promoted, and certain other films don't get promoted. And this is, through the censor, also a dialogue with a future audience, yeah? Which means the dialogue is not happening. Yeah, it's there, virtually is there, but it's not happening at all. And so forth. Yeah? So, a dialogue with an audience is not always a happy one. Yeah, I would almost think that most of the time, you create more misunderstanding than than you got understood. I will a little bit later on elaborate a little bit more on that, on this kind of misunderstanding. So, and of course, another dialogue you as an artist have is with critics of your profession, right? They might put your work down and lash out at you and whip you, and you're very unhappy. And that's a dialogue that's also very unfortunate. So all these things happen. Yeah, it's not just one uniform. Here's the dialogue with the audience. Yeah, in fact, it's very multifaceted. It has very aspects to it, and it has positive and negative parts to it, and this is actually a very complex communication or dialogue. But of all, at the basis of it, you must understand that deep down, any communication actually is not one that is always containing only an exchange of understanding. At the basis of any communication is also some adversarial thing at work. That's why you fight so much when you talk to people, yeah? Right? It's still communication, right? But you discuss things vehemently. Yeah, you battle, you fight with other people. And that's, of course, something you can, as an artist, you can choose this attitude, you can choose to enforce this attitude. And in fact, a lot of artists do that. They want to offend the audience. I mean, remember the Surrealists, remember Buñuel. They were all the time trying to provoke that at the end of the show, there would be a huge fight in a place like this. Right, and the police would have to come in, which is a little bit extreme, but artists, as you know, like to do that. That's a communication. And it is actually in what communication is all about. It nourishes that, it wants that, it carries that. Okay, now I'm stepping forward because I do have to move on. I'm stepping forward to another dialogue. You don't only have a dialogue with your audience. Lévi-Strauss said you also have a dialogue with your model. And I'm sorry, I have to explain that. He uses model because this little quote deals with painting, with non-abstract painting, right? So where you depict something, and he calls what the painter has in front of his easel, yeah, with his how do you call it? Leinwand. Well, anyway, the piece, the board on which you paint, you have the canvas. Thanks. Good. Thank you. Yeah. So I'll need your help, I guess, more often. You have a dialogue with that too. I mean, first, in choosing what you want to pay, you have a vista there. Let's say, a huge mountain, yeah? You still would have to decide, go I to the left, to the right, do I really pick this? Do I stress the height of it? Or do I more stress the grounding of the mountain and so forth? So that's a dialogue with what he calls the model. For a filmmaker, of course, it's a dialogue with the subject that is in front of your camera, be it a person, be it a house, be it a road, or the sky, or whatever. Yeah, you are kind of speaking to or talking to, or I should say, you're not talking. You're in communication with that object, with that subject. You make selections. You see certain things being prominent that you like, or prominent features of the subject that you don't like and would like to omit or put at a in a place where it's not as obvious and doesn't hit the eye first thing. So this kind of dialogue is the dialogue with the model he speaks about. Of course, if you take this dialogue a little bit wider conceptually, it's a dialogue with the world in which you also are, the times in which you live, the places in which you are, the experience you make and other people make. Yeah, so it also has a overall big frame around it. Yeah, and usually you pick only a little thing out of the whole world, but it's still, this little thing is still part of the whole world. Yeah, so it's tied in there, although you have only, for one reason or another, the possibility just to work on a little part of it. You're still in a dialogue with your times. You're still in the dialogue, in a dialogue with your world, and with other people and so forth. But another, and this is usually the most interesting dialogue, is actually you also have a dialogue, you're in a dialogue with your artistic, aesthetic tools. Yeah, it's not that you that painting is just an outflow of your nature, your talent, or something like that. Actually, you're appropriating your aesthetic tools, and you have to think of the aesthetic or artistic tools in a wider sense, right? It's a certain a scale of colors that will, when you're a painter, that you think should occur in your painting. And this is your dialogue, your discussion, and you object certain other colors. You don't use them, or you hate them. And that's why you use them a lot more, right? Because you had to live your hatred. And things like that. So, but you are in a constant dialogue with what the tools are. And of course, by that, because these tools are not just there, you don't invent your tools. They are there. They're actually year hundreds of painting, of artist work, who developed all these possibilities, these techniques, these various types of paints and so forth. When you make films, it's the same. I mean, you make your first film, but you don't invent film with that. Maybe for yourself you do that. Actually, there have been made films before you. So there is already, out of the past, a huge accumulation. But you make your specific own choices in that dialogue with that. So, to your artistic means or tools, of course, belong all the other films, right? It's not only the lenses. It's not only the cameras that are available. They are part of the artistic tool. Yeah, but you have a choice there, and you can make preferences and so forth. And so, but you constantly think or should think about it. Just imagine, until 1940, there was no proper wide-angle lens available for filmmaking, for the camera, 35 millimeter camera. And then there was one genius cinematographer, his name is Greg Toland. He developed with technicians a new lens that was the shortest lens at that time, 18 millimeter lens. This was the first wide angle, and it was used in Citizen Kane for the first time. And it gave Orson Welles and Toland the chance, for example, for the first time, not for the first time, to direct not only horizontally or vertically, they could direct, which means enfold the story into the depth of a space, which was impossible before, because you didn't have that depth of field of depth with the normal lens. Yeah, so you couldn't do these things. Everything before and after the lens would be obscure, would be out of focus, right? And for the first time, they could do something like that. For the first time is not quite right, but for example, Renoir did that already, but not with his lens. Yeah, he had different lenses. For example, in La Règle du Jeu, he had a lot of passages that were using depth of field. Something, should I speed on? No? Okay. So, all of a sudden there are new means, and of course, it's always the question if you want to use them or not. It's your choice. Yeah? So this is the dialogue, for example, when you're a filmmaker. It's there. You're always there. Or another example. When you make one shot, conceive of one shot, you always have to think not only on that shot to get it. You have to think of the shot that should come before or is coming before that shot. And you have to think and work on the shot that comes after. So whenever you are working on one shot, you're actually working on three shots. Very often, the filmmaker is not aware of that. You know, he always thinks in this little just given actual task and not thinking about what comes before that and what after. Because if you think of the three shots, you might need to use a different lens or a different angle. It has, these three shots have to be editable. Yeah? They must fit each other or must go, must build up a conflict or something like that. But this doesn't happen just by chance or because you wish. No, you have to do it. So you always have to work on three shots in a situation where just creating that one shot is already a hell of a piece of work, right? So that's why usually people forget it, yeah, because you're just involved in this single task. But no, it's not enough. So that's a dialogue with your means as well, right? Okay, so. Let me see. Oh, I used an hour already. Yeah, so I cut a little bit. So I somewhat tried to explain what Lévi-Strauss meant with the three dialogues, and I would like to ask you, don't forget that ever. Try to remember it when you're at work. Yeah, it's part of how you organize your work. Yeah, that's important, not to forget some essentials that are important, and you should never forget. Yeah, of course, there are some people, maybe I go into that, there are some people were really not interested in anything but being a successful filmmaker. And so what they do is they engage only in one dialogue, which is that one, with the audience. They want to please the audience, and whatever dialogue they have with the artistic devices, with their means, is just how do I get to please them? Yeah. So most likely, if you want to please your audience, you go with what they are used to, and you avoid anything that will challenge them, that will make them feel uneasy, right? So all of a sudden, the dialogue with the audience becomes the biggest, yeah, and all the other one are just of much lesser interest, right? Or, I mean, that's a, I have to tell you, I'm honest, I have to tell you that very often you love just the dialogue with your aesthetic, artistic tools. Yeah, that's what you care about. Yeah. So you just, if you're a painter, you just think about painting. You don't think about the category of the model, the thing you want to depict. Yeah, you don't want to depict anything. You are just about colors and how you attach them to whatever surface. Yeah, and of course then you end with abstract painting, yeah, with action painting. Yeah, where just the process of creating that image is documented in the painting. Yeah, that's somewhat depicted, yeah, but nothing else there. So this is the kind of extreme, I would say, extreme dialogue at the expense of the other two dialogues with your audience and with the model, yeah. And so you see, that's things. I mean, I said I'm kind of in the same danger of being so interested in the filmmaking itself. Yeah, in for example, I find myself always when I shoot something, I'm more interested in the shot we are making than what I'm shooting, the actor in front of the camera. So they don't interest me a lot. Yeah, or does the audience understand what I'm doing here, and so forth? It's so much more fun to put the camera on tracks and have a sweeping camera movement there on the dolly, rather than thinking, is that appropriate at this moment? Yeah, and that's where I'm a little bit in danger. So I know what I'm talking about here. Yeah. So I'm coming back now from the perspective of a documentary filmmaker to the dialogue with the model or with the world in front of the camera. When you're a documentary filmmaker, of course, you don't really invent your subject. Yeah, usually it's given. The world exists, and you're not the god of it, or godlike creating it when you make a documentary, right? You're facing something that's out there and has actually a life in its own right and its own integrity of being there, and it's a right to be there. You can't really change that. So you can only make an image of it. And that's all you can do. But you can't put some powder on it or some mask or something. It has to be what it is, right? Which always creates this authorial, as an author, if you think of yourself as an author, as a creator, slightly that's why so many people don't like to make documentaries. They're disgusting it because they don't create the world in front of the camera. They are forced to accept what's in front of the camera. They are not author. So in a way, they're only the half author of the film. Yeah, they are the author of where the lens starts. Almost, it's not quite literally because you still set lighting and so forth. But basically, it's where the camera starts, your authorship starts. Very often, it's this authorship, this little already mutilated authorship, isn't much. Yeah? It's just taking in, it's just recording it. Yeah? And you have not much to do. Maybe a little bit of your authorship is felt in the choice, in the selecting of that object that's in front of the camera, yeah? But it's that's it, yeah? Or I could give you another example from writing. In former times when there was no book printing, of course, there were copyists, people who would have one text, and in order to multiply it, they would write it on another piece of paper, and another piece of paper, and another piece of paper. And you don't see any authorship there at all, right? But there is very often, because you could see this guy, this copyist, made one mistake, and he made it on each page he was writing, so he was somewhat obsessed, obviously, with. And that little thing, maybe a comma at the wrong place, or a forgotten comma, that's his authorship, right? It goes that far, right? And sometimes your authorship is right very often in the cut in the beginning and the cut in the end. Yeah, nothing more. And in between, the camera rolled. And whatever was in front of the camera was there and did whatever it did, or it did nothing, and you got nothing there. So there is this this kind of communication with the model, with the subject, with the world, is rather complicated, which very often leads to a kind of frustrating recognition that actually you're truly in a dialogue with your subject, with what the film is all about. And the film in itself will tell you quite a bit how it begs to be made. Not the film, excuse me, the object begs the maker of the film how it will be made. There's one wonderful example I could, unfortunately we don't have it with us. It's a film by Depardon, who had the task, or he's chosen the task to make a film on New York. And he stayed weeks and weeks in New York, walked around with his camera, drank a little bit of water. And it was frustrating. He couldn't capture what New York is. And New York didn't want him to understand New York. It was completely refusing to cooperate. So all of a sudden, the artist was in a dialogue with the model, and the model refused to the dialogue. Yeah? It went silent. So, but he shot and shot. The film is called New York, New York. And he was frustrated, packed his camera in the case, and left and went back to France. And forgot about the whole project. Only years later, it happened to him for one reason or another, he himself wasn't aware of it. He took a look at some of the footage he shot back then, 10 years ago or even longer. And there were three shots that were interesting. One was a long shot, I don't know, if you know New York, there is a huge bridge Brooklyn. And next to it is a gondola. Yeah, it's going like the bridge to the other side. And you can go also in the gondola if you have no car. And you take the gondola. And he took the gondola once at morning from the other side, from Brooklyn, getting in to New York. It's one shot. Maybe it takes like 5 minutes or 10 minutes, I'm not sure. It's a long, long take. And you just see the bridge, the traffic on the bridge, and in the end, you're almost buried in the high rises where this rope ends. And then comes another shot, which is the crossroad in New York, which he almost shot just by chance. It was a coffee shop he was every day sitting in, mourning about this film he couldn't put his hand on, and drinking a coffee. And this coffee shop had a big window that would just lead to the out to the to that crossroad. There are big walls and a few people who walked there this way, that way. And one day he just put the camera on the table and filmed a little bit of it. So this footage he reviewed later, this was something that was peculiar, out of the ordinary, strange, so he took that aside too. And then he paired that shot, the second shot, with another shot yet from the bridge, only he took it this time from out New York at the evening and went in the gondola over to the other side of the river. And that's his film of New York. So it's a film. If you think and know, he tells a little bit what I just told about the this film. It's actually the voiceover. It's like three, four sentences where he explains how this film came to life by accident. It's obviously a document of the model, of the object, or the subject refusing the making of a film, or at least a more sophisticated film, right? Remember very much when I showed that film to my American students, they were furious. They were furious. This, how dares this guy to call this film New York? Why this title? It's boring, it's a crime. New York is wonderful, it's big, so many facets. But for him, at this given time, it was a closed book that he couldn't open, right? So this can happen as well. And it is New York. It is New York that doesn't love a filmmaker. Yeah, certain. No, it's true. Yeah, it's totally rejecting this guy. Yeah, it was not accessible. So all of a sudden you see this dialogue from a different perspective, right? Again, not very friendly dialogue. But it tells you one, that you always deal with subjects that do have their own life. And at this point, I always compared documentary filmmaking actually as working with ready-mades. You remember Duchamp? At one point he was thinking something is missing to the arts. Oh, it doesn't have a urinal. The arts need a urinal. No, I'm kidding. No. I'm kidding. But at some point, obviously, his eyes fell on a urinal. And he actually saw that okay, it's an object that has a certain purpose, a certain function. You find it in always, in very spatially, in very specific places. And there it is, and nobody looks at it. Okay, you take a look at it, but you don't actually see that this, if you take a step away from the function it has, that it has actually a very interesting man-made shape, a conscious shape. And so this is something that actually doesn't tell. Of course it tells about it, doesn't tell of human needs and so forth, or male needs and male bodies and so forth. It actually also tells about the people who made it, who invented it, who gave it this shape, who worked on it. And then he took it out there and placed it upside down in a gallery against the wall. And all of a sudden, this became, as a ready-made, it became a piece of art. It was never conceived of as a piece of art. It was there. It was part of the world. And so this is what you do as a filmmaker. You are confronted with a ready-made world out there, and you extract certain, since you can't, your picture is always like this, but the world is always like that, limitless. So you can only show particles of it, or fragments of it, which means you have to cut it out. But on the other hand, and that's almost a moral question that always comes with the documentary, while you cut it out, you still have to take care that the integrity of the object is still respected. Yeah? If you kind of take a hammer and smash it, the urinal, it's kind of doesn't have really much sense. And it's not a sight, it doesn't tell anymore anything. So you have to respect, at least with ready-mades. You are not the author of the ready-made. Yeah? In fact, Duchamp authorized this urinal. He put the name in the form of signature of the guy who made that urinal, the who fabricates that. And so he's the artist. Yeah? But giving the idea that I said earlier, the subject sometimes talks back to you and tells you what you can do with it and what not. This is understanding the world that's there confronting the camera, that they are as much author as you wish to be. So, but this is something that also I think a documentary filmmaker should never forget, that you do have your aesthetic choices. You do have possibilities, niches, or corners, or venues to be an author in the sense that you create something. But in the end, if you look at all and everything, it's just so much. Yeah, it's, the world speaks back. In order to this kind of to understand this situation, I always speak of there are actually, when you're making films, and especially documentary films, you're always involved in two production. There's the primary production, the first production, which is the production that is embodied in whatever is in front of the camera. Yeah, that is, the world isn't there. Even if you go through wood these days, the trees in the wood are not just by themselves there. Usually a forester has planted them, yeah, and giving the wood a certain shape or for a certain purpose. Maybe to cut them easier or something like that, or so they grow faster or whatever. Or other people plant trees or so they want to have a nice view there and things like that. So it's the world that's there and you didn't touch it at all, it's still made, and a lot of documentaries are about the first production. You ask, for example, in front of your camera, there's this poor guy, wretched, leading a miserable life, is unhappy. His fate has been just horrible. And of course, this is a first production. It happened. There's something that happened to this guy. And you want to find out who the author is of the first production. What made him so miserable? Maybe he made himself so miserable, then he's the author of that. But maybe it was his wife, or somebody else, an enemy, or maybe capitalism, right? So, this is the idea of the primary production. The secondary is the one you do, the moment when the world enters through the lens, the camera, and becomes film. That's the second production, right? So you're always, anyway, in a somewhat, at least not in a superior position as the author in the second production. You are in a dependent, as we see with Depardon, yeah, who couldn't make his film because he was dependent on his subject. You're in the dependent position. You're in the more receptive position and not in the giving position. But you can do things within a framework that you shouldn't overestimate. Do we have that here? Okay. It's a little bit far-fetched, but okay, I get the purpose. We want to show a few, as we said, a few excerpts, so I'm not just talking here all the time. I could continue.
No,
that was, yeah, let me see what I still, of course, you go prepare that. I'll immediately come back to that. Yeah, there are many more things, but at this point, I think I've exhausted the idea of the threefold dialogue, and I think that's a very basic thing for filmmakers, but also I think for any artist. So here, there's this little scene from my latest film. Could you stop it still? Yeah, once more. From my latest film, it's called Dust, and it's about dust. At some point I thought, somehow dust came into my mind, and I was thinking that actually the least object you want to make a film about. You can't make a film about dust, yeah, because it's so tiny. In fact, it's the threshold where the visible and the invisible world exist. Yeah, so it's a moment of transition, itself being a result of decay, where materia vanishes into the, at least for the eye. So it's difficult to make a film about it. And I have this kind of sportsman-like fancy attitude always to make films that are a little bit difficult to make or difficult to develop an interest for, or at least there's there must be something challenging to it. And so it was, because everybody who I asked or told, I want to make a film about dust, don't you have a few bucks? Because I needed money for that film. They said, what, dust? Dust? Why dust? Yeah, you can't see that. So I liked this idea, and I wrote, I must kind of flatter myself, I wrote an excellent proposal there after doing some research. And people were enthused to read that, because all of a sudden that was my discovery. There's a whole world out there that deals with dust. Of course, dust is present everywhere, but there are also people who deal with dust, institutions who deal with dust. There are people who are fascinated with dust. And dust, of course, is a very dangerous condition of the material, and so forth and so forth. So the magnitude of that little piece of dust was totally convincing, that I was able to have just a pretty fair budget in the end to make that film, right? So here's a little scene that deals with, actually maybe most interesting is the progress here, the way in this film is adding one aspect and one scene to each other. And I will talk about it later, afterwards. First we look at it, which is where we start. This is a facility where the German army, the military, is testing weapons. If they suffer, if they come into regions where it's very hot and very dusty, which means desert-like situation, right? They have facilities. They test. I've seen in these labs complete tanks. Yeah, so they are, a tank is, well, maybe is almost the length of this room. Right, the big tanks. And so they have labs there that are and research facilities that are easily can take in a tank, and the tank will be tested. If it has some weak point, if it can stand extreme heat, and if it has some difficult corners and such, where dust might gather, or where dust might get into the tank and maybe harm very important parts of the machinery there. Yeah? So, and they demonstrate here, the Bundeswehr, the German army, then they are how they, with a machine gun, they were testing it there. Okay.
Und eine Staubdichte von 7 Gramm pro Kubikmeter Luft.
This is inside the control room.
Hier in dem Flussdiagramm sieht man noch einmal überschlägig die Anlage in ihrer Gesamtheit. Das Flussdiagramm, wie sich allmählich die Zack-Werte der Temperatur, Luftfeuchte, Staubkonzentration dergleichen einstellen. Dies darstellen eine Klimaanlage, die sorgt dafür, dass eben auch bestimmte Temperaturen gehalten werden. Wir haben einen Prüfstaub, einen genormten Prüfstaub, der mit einer bestimmten Körnung angeliefert wird von der Herstellerfirma. Es handelt sich dabei um eine bestimmte Siebfraktion gemahlenen Sandes, der, wie Sie in der Vorbereitung ja auch gesehen haben, einige Anteile lungengängiger Partikel enthält, deswegen diese erheblichen Auflagen zur Sicherheit, die wir hier erfüllen müssen. Im Wesentlichen dient die Anlage dazu, um eigentlich Einsätze in Wüstenbereichen, Wüstenklima darzustellen, sodass man also mit Temperaturen auch bis zu 60 Grad, meine ich, und erheblichen Staubdichten und Windgeschwindigkeiten arbeiten kann, um eben auch einen Wüstensandsturm oder Staubsturm zu simulieren.
11. September 2001. Trümmer auf dem Boden, Staub, der sich durch die Straßen von Manhattan schiebt. Anwohner und Büroangestellte klagten über Kopfschmerzen, Benommenheit, Brennen im Kehlkopf, Atembeschwerden, Lungenprobleme. Ende 2003 waren mehr als 2000 Feuerwehrmänner arbeitsunfähig, auf Dauer, ohne jede Unterstützung. Im Staub fanden sich Spuren von Baumaterialien, Ruß, Mineralwolle, Papier, Glasfasern, Zellulose, Pestizide, Wasserkohlenstoff, Polyaromate, Biphenyle, Bromide, Dibenzodioxin, Chrysolit, radioaktive Nukliden, Quarz, Formaldehyd, Schwefelverbindungen, Flocken von Metallen wie Kupfer, Blei, Eisen, Quecksilber, Chrom, Aluminium, Titan, Teer, Zement, Kalk, Mangan, Barium, Arsen, Cadmium, Benzopyren, Fluor, Paraffin, Flugzeug, Treibstoff. Der ganze Müll unserer gegenwärtigen Zivilisation abgefackelt, verschmort und zermalmt zu Staub. Im Staub war auch ein gewisser Teil von organischen Stoffen, über dessen Herkunft wurde lange gerätselt. Später fand die Analyse heraus, dass dieser Staub von Menschen stammte. Hautzellen, Körpergewebe, Zellmaterial.
In diesem Fall sieht man, das Schwarze ist das Uran und das andere sind halt hier in diesem Fall Aluminiumsachen drumherum. In diesem Fall bei diesen 30, sogenannten 30 mm Geschossen ist wohl wirklich das, ist alles schwarz schon außen Uran. Also es ist schon so, dass man die Geschosse nicht anfassen soll. Also die werden halt so ummantelt und dieser hintere Teil, Abschussteil, der geht weg. Hier vorne, das, was man schwarz sieht, das ist schon eben das Uran, was da drin ist. Ein wesentlicher Grund, weswegen diese Munition verwendet wird, ist die hohe Dichte, die das Uran hat. Es handelt sich ja hier um Uran, abgereichertes Uran. Es hat eine Dichte von 19 Gramm pro Kubikzentimeter. Das ist halt höher als die meisten anderen Metalle, die meisten Elemente, die wir haben halt. Und gegeben durch die hohe Dichte erhalten die Projektile eine hohe Durchschlagskraft. Weswegen Uran auch noch genommen wird als eine Waffe, wenn es auf einen harten Gegenstand geht, sich so fast selber anspitzt. Dass es sozusagen eine sehr gute Eigenschaft hat, durch Wände durchzudringen. In dem Moment, wo ein hartes Material getroffen wird, dann stehen sehr hohe Temperaturen durch die hohe kinetische Energie. Und bei diesen hohen Temperaturen verbrennt das Uran. Und dadurch werden feinste Staubpartikel, Uranoxide, das oxidiert dann auch in dem Moment, also generell ab Temperaturen über 500 Grad, und da stehen möglicherweise Temperaturen von 1.000, 2.000 Grad bei diesen Verbrennungen, pulverisiert, brennt das Uran und dann entstehen eben diese kleinen Partikel, die von Nanometer bis Hunderten von Mikrometern reichen. Das ist halt jetzt hier Darstellung eines Partikels, eines Plutoniumpartikels, einfach nur so bildlich dargestellt in einer Lungenmatrix. Wo die Uranmunition getroffen hat, ist um 5-10 Meter Umkreis gibt es Bereiche, wo eben viel Uranstaub rumliegt. Es ist eine Sache, die halt in großen Mengen dort verschossen wurde, also groß angewandt wurde in großen Mengen. Und sicherlich ist halt die Sache, dass da halt Uranstäube auch bei entstehen, etwas Neuartiges, was bisher vor in der Hinsicht, also jetzt, dass so Stäube, die aus einem großen Teil aus unlöslichen Partikeln bestehen, auch zum Teil eben sehr kleine Partikel, sicherlich ist da eine Sache, die man bedenken muss, wie weit wird das inhaliert, gibt es da irgendwelche möglichen Folgeschäden, bedingt durch diese Aufnahme dieser Stäube halt.
Clausewitz sagt, die Kriegskunst ist im Grunde die Kunst, die gegebenen Mittel im Kampf zu gebrauchen. Viele amerikanische Soldaten waren im Krieg dem Staub von abgereichertem Uran ausgesetzt. Es gab Erkrankungen und Missbildungen von Embryos und Kindern in Amerika und im Irak. Untersuchungen wurden angestellt.
Wir haben halt die Anfrage gekriegt von einer Zeitung, diesen halt zu untersuchen. Stand halt in Verdacht, dass halt eine Missbildung seines Kindes halt im Zusammenhang mit dem seiner Zeit, die er im Irakkrieg verbracht hatte, und dabei eben die Kontamination.
Okay, so to fully understand the progress of the of this sequence, that of course consists of a couple of scenes, is that during the Cold War, of course there were always going on in the various militaries, and of course, especially in the US, by the DOD, the Department of Defense, Pentagon. Research is going on about the feasibility of the weapons, yeah, in a certain, how do they react in a certain environment. So during the Cold War, the major direction of these researchers were not heat and dust. There were always cold winter, icy winters, and swampy regions, so water. That was, and the goal of the test were if the tanks, the machine guns, and even the boots and so forth, if they were fit for the use in these conditions. Suddenly, with the fall of the Soviet Union, they immediately changed the research goal to this, yeah, to test their weapons under the condition of high temperatures and the development of lots of dust. And you can see just from this change that their strategic aims were changing from the Soviet Union back then to the Middle East. At the Middle East at that time, there was not much going on, not much engaging, but they were already testing this. So there is already this change of paradigm. Yeah, so that's the first step I'm using that comes with dust here. And then all of a sudden, you think of the Middle East, of Arabia, of Iraq, or whatsoever. All of a sudden, the dust from the Middle East comes to New York in form of exploding, burning high rises. Just make a dust desert out of New York, and of course it was the Al Qaeda reproach, and all of a sudden I'm jumping back to the Middle East, this time Iraq, because now They kind of loaded their Arabic dust, I say, down on the Americans. Now the Americans load down their dust on whoever is there in the near of their weapons, with depleted uranium. I don't know if you ever heard of that ammunition. All of it's used all over the NATO. You don't call it NATO, no? Yeah, you do. Yeah, NATO. So it's been used in Kosovo. Kosovo is kind of totally covered with ammunition from depleted uranium. And he explains very well what's so fancy about it. Depleted uranium usually is
nuclear bomb.
It's just for nuclear bomb. No, it's actually the cylinders in nuclear power facilities, right? And once they're used up, the uranium is depleted. It's still highly radioactive, but it's garbage, right? And they would have to get rid of it. But they discovered these properties of the uranium that they actually are just wonderful to use in war as the tops of any piece of ammunition. So they got it for nothing from the reactors and developed this. And when they shoot it, it's like, we don't care anymore about the uranium, but it has the terrible consequence that it's actually creating dust, nuclear dust that's pretty radioactive. And a lot of American soldiers who were deployed in Iraq were suffering from certain symptoms. And of course, we've seen that they would, if the wife would get pregnant, they would give a certain amount of radioactivity to the ovaries and the children. Yeah, I use in between, hard to see, a little photo by Sophie Ristelhuber, name. She actually made quite a lot of photographies in Iraq, and this is some photo of felt shoes, or they look like felt shoes, I say, covered in dust, of an Iraqi soldier who just disintegrated. Yeah, it's not only the shoes are left over. So I kind of have very heterogeneous sources, materials. Yeah, one is in a scientific institute in Frankfurt. Then I had this German military facility. Then I had photos from the internet, and so forth. So, and usually it's very hard to get to create a flow in your film from one point A to point B, if the materials are very heterogeneous, yeah, because then sometimes the film falls apart. Yeah? So you need, even if it's only hidden, a very strong idea how to enrich in the flow of images, to enrich a certain coherence of that material. Although it's jumping from here to there, from this aspect to that aspect, still you feel like it's one piece. Yeah, there is a certain coherence, and I'm following the argument. Although you're not fully aware of my doings there, what I thought while I was doing it and putting it together, but still it's working. It's working, and you go along with it. Yes, why not? Maybe, do you go to Volkswagen? Or could you? Maybe we go to the beginning of Volkswagen, yeah? It's always, of course, a big question, talking about the dialogue with the audience. Yeah, it's always a big question how to start a film. Yeah, I mean, it's arbitrary, but you kind of want to pull your audience into the film, right? So you have to offer something that has an immediate magnetism or attraction or something, and so it's always the question. And for this VW film, I didn't have a beginning. I couldn't think, where should I start this damn film? I had four endings. And one was, the film is mainly about car production. And from kind of old type car production that are partially still in use to the most modern, when only when the whole production is automatically mechanized by roboters, and you don't see a single person working there anymore, right? So I had the idea, I end the film when all of these cars that are going through this process of production, in the end, they're just rubble, trash, rusty metal, and so forth. So I shot this as an end of the film. The other end I shot was what happens at night when there's always a shift between I think 2 o'clock and or midnight and 8 o'clock or something, where no production is going on. What's happening there? And so in these empties, there's a production site. And I went in there and I found there is some security racing with a red with a bike through all this. But he's not only security, he's actually also a repairman. Yeah? So there are always little spots that need a repair. So on his bike, he sits there like a guerrillero with two things, belts with tools, right? But he looks like a guerrillero who's kind of driving there, yeah? So that was another end for me. And the third end is the city of Wolfsburg is dead at night. Yeah, so we shot there a little bit at night. The city looked almost deserted. Only there was a shepherd just by himself running through the streets. In Wolfsburg, which is the city where initially the VW was the only place where it was built. Yeah, so and the center of the company is there. So we shot that with the dog who kind of ran through our shots. Having in mind, of course, Hitler's favorite dog, Blondie, yeah, who he loved the shepherd dog, that here is Hitler's dog. So these were the three ends, and this was the fourth end. What I did was, after thinking, I can't have four ends. Yeah, so two ends is already a little bit exquisite. Yeah, and three is, but four, no. I made it the beginning of the film, right? Okay, and we just look at it for fun. Yeah, but this is a little bit about the, I wouldn't say disponibility of your materials, but it always gives you more choices than you think and than you initially thought while you were shooting it. Yeah, so there's a certain openness almost with each shot, a certain openness that it's not totally determined, not always at least, totally determined what its use will be. It's a little bit poor, especially since we have all the lights on. Should be a little bit louder if that's manageable.
Cars being scrapped. Archaeologists of the future will be left little to dig out.
So what do you, I think it was not understandable what the voiceover said. It is that...
The automobile...
Yeah, you can stop here. That future archaeologists will have little to discover about our period, except a little bit of rust. Yeah, so everything else will be gone. The object won't last that long. Let me think, I had something I wanted to share here. Yeah, now I'm back. When you make a film, are some filmmakers here? Please raise your hand. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, a few. And are you documentary filmmakers? Okay. Of course, you always, when you have an idea for a film, you always, of course, have to evaluate the qualities of the subject. Does it lend itself, number one? Does it lend itself to a film, right? Is there something that actually has some affinity to a moving picture, right? That's the very first question. And the other one in this evaluation process is, what kind of reality is this? And I make the distinction between strong reality and more soft reality. For example, to explain, strong reality would be if you make a film that is actually in the middle of a wartime and you go move with the camera into the battle. Yeah.
How long have you been in the place before you started?
Here, this one. This morning, right? But can we hold back on this question for a moment? I'll talk about that. War situation. I mean, there are bombs, people fight, and literally the look of the site, the whole site itself, is changing in the middle. Yeah, it's happening in the moment you shoot. Of course, that's very strong. It's almost like an action film. Yeah, so you're in the middle of something that's happening truly in front of the camera. That's strong reality. Of course, not each and every subject has this kind of strength. Yeah, very often not. For example, an example of a soft reality would be somebody sits close up for the camera and this person tells how bad he felt 30 years ago, right? So the reality there is very far away. Yeah, it's not strong. He can talk as convincing as he might be able to. But still, it's not a strong reality for the film. So you have these kind of opposites and a lot of things in between. Yeah. So this year, I would actually say it's more a little bit of soft reality. Yeah, it's not much moving there. There are objects that are just sitting there, but still you see them as a result of strong forces. That's obviously visible. So it's kind of promising energies. Yeah, it throws the image of future energies that you might encounter here. So this actually made, at least for me, the beginning, the choice to use this as the beginning of the end and not as the graveyard at the end of a film, to use this as the beginning, because it also foreshadows something. Yeah, so I thought I can use it. Yeah, after the analysis of the pictures. Yeah, that's something that you always have to do after you've been shooting, kind of in cold blood. Look at your footage and watch out if it's good and what's telling you. Actually, it might not always, in fact, very rarely, it might actually do what you planned it to be in the first place when you shot it. But very often you didn't get it, and very often you got something else. So that's looking carefully at the rushes. Yeah, at the footage that you shot is of highest importance, because then you discover qualities that you might want to take use of in the editing. So that's something one should never forget to do, because you decide, or when you shoot something, or pick something, select something, you always are in the state of wishful thinking. You want this thing to do this, this is supposed to tell it. But later on, when you look at the footage, and there are many reasons why it doesn't go that way, one is that your cinematographer didn't quite understand what he was supposed to do. That's very often happening. Or your wishful thinking, we're seeing something and it was telling you something, in fact it didn't tell it. So, and you end up with a lot of moments and footage that seemed so great to you, and they're rubbish once you open the cap. Yeah, so that's a very bad experience one can have. Yeah, and especially bad is if you continue with your wishful thinking, kind of believing this material is saying this, because it's only your wish that it tells you. Nobody else sees it in there, right? And you cut it in, and you don't, you wonder, yet, no, they don't get it. Yeah? It doesn't tell, it doesn't do it. Yeah? So this is a very dangerous situation. And that's another advice I give you. For my taste, young filmmakers, meaning students, they start editing way too early. Yeah, they hardly have looked at their material, or they're still shooting, and they start already editing. Which is a little bit like if you're a painter, when you paint in the left corner, you start your painting without knowing what will be in the middle and the central forces of the image be, or so. But you start there because you can't wait anymore. Yeah, you want to edit the film. You have this footage. Let's try it out. Yeah, and of course you're not in command of all the other stuff that you've done, and you don't know where the strong points are and where the soft points are. But you edit already, and it's somebody who's sewn a dress or something. Once it's done, you don't want to take it apart again, right? So you leave it at that. And it's sure that your film isn't as good as it could be, only because you didn't have the patience to look at your footage one time, two times, three times, four times, and know it then by heart. Yeah, and truly look at it and say, that's bad, it has to go out of my film. And this is good, that's a strong shot, I have to save that. I don't know how I will use it, but that I need that one. Yeah, this will be a strong point of my film. So, and then you start to become inventive. You showing me that? Okay, good. Good, I shut up. Okay, oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. So that was your question.
How long have you been there?
Where? In this one place.
Yes.
I think I've never been there before. I think my assistants picked it out. Yeah. We thought of other places. We didn't get access to it, so this was the only one where we could shoot, for example, when I made this film Staub, that was originally a plan to be shot in the US, but then I kind of moved back to Europe, and then I made it here. Most places I've never seen before. In fact, very often, I meet also persons for the first time, the camera already with me, and being built up, and I've never seen these people. I know, because my assistants talk to them. I like that, because it's, to me as a filmmaker, the same challenge as it is for the person I'm going to portray. Yeah, this person is for the first time in this situation, being confronted with a camera, and I'm with this person, confronted with a person for the first time. So we have equal chances. Usually directors don't like that. They want to be in control. Yeah, so they kind of either talk themselves weeks or at least a day before with that, or inspect a place a lot. No, I want to have my instant spontaneous is wrong, my instant impressions, and then I love to make on the same spot aesthetic decisions. Yeah, so there's some vividness to it. That's the wonderful thing, if in contrast to narrative movie, where usually everything is planned before and put there on purpose by somebody, because you've talked about it and everybody knows why it's there, and so there's no surprise anymore. Yeah, and the actors have rehearsed this, and there's a script that tells why things are happening and why and so forth, in which way and so forth. So I always love as a challenge a moment or an element of unpredictability. Yeah, so I'm in the same position as they are. And there's another effect, especially if you interview and talk to people, is they tell you once whatever you want them to tell. If you ask them to do it the second time, it's not as strong anymore. It's almost like people are ashamed to tell things twice. Yeah, so you will discover that. And they shorten it, for example. They're much faster, they leave out things, yeah, because they said it 5 minutes ago, they just said it already. So they don't want to repeat themselves, which is understandable, but usually the first take is the best in this case. Yeah. Yeah.
And put myself in the place,
yeah,
of the subject, you know.
Yeah.
What I have to got to show to the people.
Yes.
What I am.
Yeah.
Shine.
I would actually tell every student to do it like you do. Yeah, no, true. Yeah. You've got to know something about it. But on the other hand, I know also, as an experienced filmmaker, you always have to have a little niche for a secret. Yeah, something that's unknown. Some things that you don't command, that's a little bit alien or in that sense. Yeah. So this is, I believe, something, maybe I can afford it as an old dog making films for more than 40 years or so, that I can deal with it that way. I would actually, because otherwise, I know people who are not prepared. Usually these are the journalists. Yeah, they come to you, what should I ask you? And has no idea what they want to interview me. And they ask me what they should ask. This is something you encounter very often, and they have no idea what their job is. Yeah, why you were picked to be interviewed, right? No idea. So that's the worst thing with, don't go there. Don't come with your camera right away. Yeah. So so your approach is more decent, at least, and maybe also more productive. Yeah. You're right. But it's a thing. So there's a gain in your method, right? But also there's a certain loss, probably possible, not guaranteed. It will be there, but the danger of it is there. Yeah, there's a.
So you prefer to take the place of the public instead of take the place of the people you want to show in your film. That's what
good question also.
Like, yeah. not going 1 week before to know,
yes,
the thing that you want, yeah, to.
Of course, there's the Flaherty tradition, yeah, which is you've got to live with these people, not 14 days. Yeah, you really got to live with them. Yeah, and then you know about them, which is true. Yeah, no doubt. On the other hand, the same thing with Flaherty was, do you know probably Nanook, the Eskimo, yeah, who shows how he's living, how he's a hunter. And during the film, he actually, although we see him hunting, he never hunts. Yeah, he shows hunting. Yeah. So Flaherty had to feed him. Yeah, although his hunting is his livelihood. Yeah, it was not place for the two things. Yeah, because of course the presence of the camera, and the camera always affords certain things, actually disables him to hunt while he's showing hunting. He's doing the exact gestures and using the exact tools and everything. Still, he can't hunt. Yeah. So, I mean, there's something, it's not guaranteed that you really get the truth, more truth out of it, because Flaherty was doing both, right? He was staging the whole thing with Nanook on the one hand, but he knew exactly what he needed to show, and so on. Yeah. No. In CalArts in America, he was at that time living in San Francisco. I invited him, and he immediately split the student body with his remarks, because he said, "Why are you here in film school? You've got to walk by foot through America from here and there." This is his thing. And they said, one group said he's an idiot. And the other one were, of course, fancied by this stupid stuff. Herzog is very often telling, right? Yeah. So, but I invited him, and he was there. So, and I know him. So it's not that.
I'd like to pose you a question about the time we are living now. And when I look at your work, I see that the subjects you choose have particular purposes, mm-hmm, because they aim at certain connections between, for instance, technology and war,
mm-hmm,
war and political power, etc. And I'd like to ask you, as a simple question, there are today millions of possible subjects, but in the precise time we are living in,
yeah,
in Europe, for instance, what do you think one should go after? I know that every filmmaker has its own subjects, interests,
yeah,
personal history, etc. But I'm asking this question in terms of the political task of contemporary filmmaking, particularly in documentary. What do you think are the things that it's urgent to be shown, to be researched, to be denounced, for instance? What would be your reflection about such a question?
Well, you know, I do understand, but this is actually never a question I ask myself. I don't do that, yeah. I don't feel that I'm in the position to decide this, yeah, what's, yeah. It's usually going the other way. I meet what I said earlier, maybe a piece of strong reality or soft reality, and I'm attracted to it. And then I try to explore the capacity of this object, yeah, what's in there. And then I discover these things as being materialized in this object or in this subject. After research, after some contemplation, after a lot of research or so, I see all of the riches that are given in something. It's not that I'm like an agent or a politician myself who's kind of looking and saying, oh, that's a subject that, yeah, not so important. We have to do something about that. In the end, that's why I don't do it. In the end, you never can be sure about the effectivity of your film, right? There are so many imponderabilities given, even with the times when you make a film and finally show the film. Yeah, it might be 2 years between that. For example, I'll give you one example. When I kind of discovered the subject of the B-52, this nuclear bomber, and started to research there, I had the idea, because Russia and the USA were kind of having come to a treaties where they would reduce their nuclear capabilities. And part of it was destroying most of the B-52s, for example, on the American side. So the subject for me had this perspective, oh, maybe this is the jumping board to get even more activity. So I was asking myself just this question. This will be a jumping board to get to an international ban on any nuclear weapon. Yeah, it looked like. And so I thought, maybe I can contribute a little bit with this film. Only to discover a little bit later that while they had these treaties already made, Reagan was again secretly, or not secretly, I can't decide on that. He was engaged in rearmament, nuclear rearmament of the American military. And so while I was in this project, I saw how the outer conditions of it already changed. Okay, I finished the film, and it was shown in the US 2001 in November, so after 9/11. People were angry at me that I made a film against an American weapon system. They were really angry. And so even decent people who would at other times think that, okay, the American military is pretty imperialist, they wouldn't want to think that thought for 1 second. So the film failed in the US, yeah? I had practically no audience for 14 days, although I had also good reviews, but I had reviews like that, yeah? Something like, we bombed too few German. Yeah, he should be among, should have been amongst them. Yeah, but we bombed German and got Hitler away and things like that. So
It's a pity to we have to end this truly great masterclass because Hartmut has an engagement in Lisbon at 6 o'clock.
At 6 o'clock, I have.
I think we should do a strong clap to thank you to Hartmut.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so have a good evening. I understand that this is the week of the evaluation and you're under a lot of stress, so maybe we had some distraction here, yeah. So